Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the seventh meeting of the Education and Skills Committee? Can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting? The first item of business is to take evidence in the draft Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002, brackets Time for Compliance Regulations 2016. And I welcome to the meeting Joe Fitzpatrick, Minister for Parliamentary Business, and government officials Andrew Gunn, FOI Policy Officer, and Emlyn Williams, Solicitor. Good morning. I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement of around 5 minutes.
Thank you, Convener. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to say a few words in support of this motion. The proposed Time for Compliance Regulations are a pragmatic response to issues raised in last year's consultation on extending coverage of Freedom of Information Scotland Act 2002. During the consultation process, the Grant Aided and Independent Special Schools proposed for inclusion within the scope of the FOI Act highlighted the practical difficulties in responding to requests within the standard 20 working days due to school holidays. The Act allows for variation in response timescales in particular circumstances, and I am very sympathetic to the position of these schools now required to comply with FOI regulations. Unlike local authority schools, grant-aided and independent special schools are public authorities in their own right for the purposes of freedom of information. Given these schools are generally closed during holiday periods with very limited administrative staff, usually working term times only, this clearly creates practical difficulties in responding to FOI requests during holiday periods. There is precedent for these proposals in other legislation, such as the Pupils Educational Records Scotland Regulations 2003, which requires the release of information within timescales calculated by school days rather than by working days. I welcome the broad support for these proposals, including from Capability Scotland, the Royal Blind School, Kibble Education and Care Centre, and also from the Scottish Information Commissioner. In particular, I note the Commissioner's observations that the regulations are, in practice, a backstop for the schools involved. However, I also note the concerns expressed in some responses, including that of the Campaign for Freedom of Information in Scotland, that the proposed regulations creates a two-tier system. The campaign emphasised the need for a process of qualification and independent verification for agreeing when schools are recognised as being closed, and that such a process could be overseen by the Scottish Information Commissioner. This is, in effect, what will happen, and I hope that allays the concerns of the campaign and of others. It's the independent Scottish Information Commissioner who oversees and enforces Scotland's freedom of information laws. In addition, in consultation with the Commissioner, I propose to revise the Section 60 Code of Practice to emphasise the statutory duty to respond to requests promptly, and that if staff with the appropriate skills, knowledge and authority are available, it would be good practice to respond to any requests, even if these regulations apply. I believe the proposed regulations, in tandem with the revision strengthening the Code of Practice, are sensible and take into account the specific circumstances of these schools now subject to Freedom of Information Law. As with the order extending coverage to these regulations relate, it's our intention to review the impact later this year. The review will help to inform our ongoing aim of keeping Scotland's freedom of information legislation effective and fit for purpose. And I hope the committee will support the motion when it comes.
Thank you very much. Liz, you've got a question for you.
This is a point of clarification, Minister. Can I just ask, obviously it is a pragmatic problem that has arisen. Has it come about because there is a substantial increase in the number of FOI requests to that type of school? Is that one of the...
No, this is a new coverage. So coverage FOI was extended to include these schools in orders we placed last year, and it came into effect in September of this year. So this is about extending coverage to extend the rights of freedom of information to cover the schools here. So prior to the changes we brought forward, these schools were not covered. So it's a pragmatic exercise to accept that in extending the coverage to include these schools, that there are particular and very specific difficulties in complying with the 20 days during school holidays.
Okay, thank you for that. And just secondly, I mean, you don't foresee any, you mentioned about a possibility of a two-tier system. You don't foresee any challenge to that?
No, I think this is very, very, very specific circumstances for these very specific institutions. They're generally very small institutions, which do actually close down in the main at school holidays. We have based the definition on already in use. As I said, there's already a definition of what a school day is. I can't think of any other organisation which is the same as these schools. So we have freedom of information covers a whole host of organisations, and I can't see any other organisation that we currently cover which could claim the same exemption. So it's a very, very specific, point that we're having to address.
Thank you for that. I mean, I just seeing it from other schools' perspectives, you know, obviously they closed down too during holidays, and that's where I had a slight concern over a legal challenge because it was seen as, you know, different rules for one and his, but you're happy with that.
The big difference between these schools and local authority schools is that it's the local authority schools are not the the responsible body. It's the local authority that's the responsible body, and that's the big difference. Whereas with these schools, it will be the Royal Blind School that will be the local authority for it, the responsible body, for instance. And if there is nobody there, then I think that would be a particular difficulty.
Okay, thanks, Mr. Joy.
Thanks very much. You say it's a pragmatic response to a problem, but you've confirmed that we don't know whether the problem exists yet or not.
Well, it was something that came up in the consultation. So the schools that we were proposing to extend coverage to raised the issue that how could they respond in the classic idea of 20 working days when they were in fact closed for school holidays. And I think I must make the point again that these schools are different from local authority schools in that they are generally very small institutions which are closed. Now, clearly, the code that we've added in as well, which I hope you all received a copy of the draft wording of that, which I thought might be helpful, makes it clear that if there are people in the school, then you know it should be responded to, and that this regulation does not remove the requirement for all public authorities to respond promptly.
I note that the Children and Young People's Commissioner is opposed to this proposal.
The Children and Young People Commissioner made some comments, which I think, I hope, we have taken on board in the code. I think the point I would make is that this is about extending coverage to these schools. So prior to the change in FOI, these schools were not covered. So they only started being covered this September.
You see, I think there is a difficulty. First of all, you're identifying a solution to a problem that we have no evidence actually it's going to be a major problem for schools. They have said they think it might be a problem. Equally, if you said, well, it actually is a problem for schools because schools closed during the summer, the logic of that position is it would apply to all freedom of information requests around schools, because while the local authority is working and functioning, the evidence that you would need to get for a specific FOI around what's happened in a particular school would have to come from the school, which in itself might not be in a position to provide that information. I wonder if you had considered the other option, which was to say it should be 20 days, but you would allow the Information Commissioner to be able to look at the guidance on the reasons why they couldn't comply within the 20 days and, you know, recognise, well, we're actually closed over the summer, so that was a problem. Would that have addressed perhaps the problem that people perceive that this is a dilution of the Freedom of Information Act for a very specific group, while, in fact, if there is a big problem, it should be recognised for schools right across the board rather than specifically for those in
terms
the independent sector.
Sorry, I think we need to go back to the point that the responsible body, there's a major difference here. The responsible body in local authorities is the local authority who generally have, who all, I think, have FOI units who manage their casework. And also, the 20 days still stands, but it's so that is still there, so it's 20 working days. The terminology of what a school day is already laid out in legislation. It's already understood in the law as so I think that there is a big difference there in terms of the 20 days. It still applies. Clearly, if the school is not open, then there is that challenge. And I guess the code also makes it clear that if there are staff who are capable of answering the FOI, so it might be that there are some of these schools might have somebody in for a period of time, then they should that that these regulations shouldn't then apply, and it would be then for the Information Commissioner to police that, and it is just, absolutely
but
for the...
given the fact that you're saying some of these schools may be open, some people might have somebody, some of these schools indeed will have a broader board that would be able to access information, would it not be more logical to start the other way round, to say is how do you produce procedures which can be flexible given the nature of these schools, as opposed to shifting immediately to a pragmatic solution which exempts one part of the education system but doesn't recognise the challenges elsewhere?
Nobody's been exempted here. So if the school is open, then the exemption doesn't start counting. So it's a working day as normal. If the school is open, it's a working day as normal. So I think what we've done is something that takes account of the facts. So it's not just about, like, this is a perceived problem. If the schools are closed for 40 days, I think we looked at the kind of average might be 30 days around the summer, the kind of longest period. So then it would be very difficult for them to respond within 20 days if they're actually, I mean, the chances are they wouldn't even open the FOI letter, wouldn't necessarily be seen. So this is something that came up in the consultation as we were proposing to extend FOI. Remember, I think this is about extending FOI to cover these schools which previously were not covered. When we brought forward the order to do that, I thought it was correct that parents and other interested parties had the right to that same FOI coverage elsewhere. But in doing so, clearly, as a responsible government, we consult about how that should be taken forward, and I was pleased that organisations like Capability Scotland, the Royal Blind School and others have said, yes, this addresses a problem which they identified. And I think the other point we would say is that we have said that we will look at the whole aspect of this a year on and confirm that it is working as we expect. Our experience of other extension of FOI has been that actually it hasn't ended up being as onerous as people had at first been concerned about. So where we extended to cover leisure trusts, for instance, there was concerns that this would be a real challenge for those organisations. But in practice, with working in partnership with the Information Commissioner to make sure that those organisations had the skills and were prepared, actually, in reality, it wasn't such an onerous extension of FOI. And I think that should be remembered. This is about extending FOI. That's what this is about.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Fitzpatrick, you've made much of the, and rightly, of the local authority being the responsible body, but the government proposed to change the law in respect of education to make schools the responsible body. Are there any implications of that change?
Right now, I obviously will have to deal with what's there just now. I don't see any implications that would change the local authorities being the responsible bodies.
But will there be some assessment of that when the law changes? I mean, it's your government that proposes change.
One of the things that I hope colleagues will have seen is that over the last few years we've been working very hard to make sure that our freedom of information laws keep up to date.
Sure.
And so I think that is absolutely appropriate that we should do that. But my starting point is about how we can make sure that people who require information can access that information in as easy and as understandable way forward.
I could put it the other way around. Could I have the assurance, or could the committee have the assurance, that if that law change takes place, the freedom of information implications for schools will be considered carefully at the time that this committee is considering that legislation next year?
Clearly, if there was a change to who responsible bodies were in any aspect, then we would need to look at how that implies on people's rights, and it's something that the Information Commissioner has raised as well.
Okay, thanks very much, Minister. Can I just ask that if there are any changes, and if you the review after a year, you'll be making sure that the committee is fully informed of?
Yeah, I think it's reasonable that we should keep the committee informed of the outcome of our review.
Okay, thanks very much. Right, we'll then move on to item two, unless anybody's got any further questions. No. Which is a formal debate on motion S5M-1751 in the name of the Minister. I remind everyone that officials are not permitted to contribute to the formal debates, and I ask the Minister to move the motion.
Formally moved.
Thank you very much. Does anybody have any contribution to make? No. I will then put the question to the committee that motion S51-01751 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. The committee must report to Parliament on this instrument. Are members content for me, as convener, to sign off a report? Thank you. We then move on to agenda item three. The next item on the agenda is to consider two negative instruments as noted on the agenda. These are negative instruments, as I said, and will come into force unless Parliament agrees to a motion to annul it. No motion to annul has been lodged. Do members have any comments on the Children's Service Planning Specified Date Scotland Order 2016? Thank you. Do members have any comments on the Education Student Loan Scotland Amendment?
To note that there was quite significant correspondence from the Delegated Powers Committee, who seemed to be quite concerned about this issue, about whether this would actually address the problem. I don't know whether it is something we want to do something about now, but I think they did write to us in some detail about their concerns, and I wondered if there's been any advice taken about what the implications of what they're saying is. First of all, that there wasn't an equality impact assessment, and that they don't think that raising age to 60 will address the problem that was identified of it being discriminatory at 55.
Okay, I believe that 60 is the standard age across the UK, isn't it? That's been raised. But anyway, we can consider this again at the meeting on the 26th of October if anybody feels it's necessary to do so. Yes, no? Would you like us to write to the Scottish Government and consider the responses of that meeting?
I think that would be useful. I mean, I was interested in the fact that the other committee took so much time to correspond with it, but something they clearly thought was quite serious. And I wonder whether it would just be for the record anyway to get a response to what they're saying.
I have personally no problems with this, but it does say in the Delegated Powers Committee report in paragraph 22 that the committee has outstanding concerns about the basis for the Scottish Government's decision. So I think we would be worth just probing a little bit further.
Okay, all right, then we'll write to the Scottish Government and we'll ask them for their view on it. Right, okay, thank you very much. We then move on to item four, the overview of early years, and at this stage could I ask the panel to, once things have changed. Oh, look, that was clever.
Sorry?
That was clever. Good morning. I'd like to welcome to the committee and on this business in early years the panel consisting of Councillor Stephanie Primrose, Claire Schofield, Director of Membership, Policy and Communications, National Day Nursery Association, Maggie Simpson, Chief Executive of Scottish Mail, the Child Minding Association, and of course Councillor Primrose is the Education, Children and Young People spokesperson from COSLA. We're going to go straight to questions, and I will start the questions by asking yourself, Councillor Primrose, about these figures that came out from the Scottish Government about the local authority spending and the amount of money that they're saying was allocated and the amount of money that they're saying that was spent on the children and young people the early years. Do you have, as COSLA, I know that COSLA made some comments saying that this is a sort of broad brush approach. Do COSLA monitor the spending at local authorities on the early years? And if they do they have figures that would suggest otherwise from what the government do?
Certainly. The issue about LFR really came to our attention a couple of months ago. And at that point, our team moved in to try and find out just exactly what was going on here. We do have concerns about the data that was used. I'll put my hand up here, I'm not an expert on LFRs by any means, but certainly we felt that one particular LFR was not representative of the overall expenditure coming from local authorities. Certainly from my own authority, and I was updated about this just the other day, we have at least three LFRs that would actually look to account for the expenditure. So certainly, the six local authorities that were identified as having the sort of largest underspend, if you like, they've all come back and said that the data that was collected was not sufficient to give an overall picture of what exactly was going on. And certainly the feeling is, if the money is there, it's accounted for and it will be spent. Again, going back to my own authority, and I'm very much aware of the fact that I'm here on Causal Business, but in my own authority, we've got a significant amount of capital builds going on, and I'm sure every other local authority is the same. So we've got designs in the planning stage, we've got designs in the design stage. So we're obviously not going to be able to spend that money until we've actually got boots on the ground, if you like. So we are absolutely confident that the money that we have been given is going to be spent wisely. And actually, my own local authority, they're actually going to spend more than they got on our early years.
Right, OK. But I go back to the question that if COSLA are saying that this is not an accurate picture of what they're spending, how do COSLA monitor that? Or do COSLA monitor that? Because I don't see how they can say it's not accurate if they've not done any work to prove that it is accurate.
There certainly has been work done up to date within this particular context of the LFR, so that has been monitored and it will continue to be monitored to ensure that we can actually account for the LFR.
From COSLA that will be refuting these figures?
Yes, absolutely, yeah. I mean, I do want to say one thing that, COSLA is very supportive of the work being done in early years, and I certainly said to the Minister that, I don't want to dwell on the LFR issue. I certainly think this is a very positive area, and COSLA engages very, very well with Scottish Government in this. So we really want to just move ahead and move into the next stage of delivering the 1140 hours.
You can surely understand the concerns of parents who are looking for places who see that in my local authority area, for example, there's a considerable underspend. And they would need a clear explanation, and surely it's incumbent on either the local authority or COSLA to have that explanation out there so that the parents aren't concerned that
we can certainly put that out. I mean, I certainly put the press statement out more as a way of almost parking that to look forward. I'd rather look forward than look back, but certainly we will put out a statement on our position if you would seek reassurance on that. We can certainly do that.
I'd like to come on to another area then on the educational benefit of 30 hours compared to 16 hours. Would anybody like to comment?
Yes, thank you, convener. I mean, I think that this is a bit of the problem, is that, that there's certainly clear evidence to show that children really do benefit from high-quality early learning and childcare. However, the quantity, the amount that they benefit is not really, there's no evidence to show that actually by the time they've been there for, say, 1140 hours, that they would actually benefit twice as much as they would do if they're not. And I suppose, from our point of view, it's very much about the balance of the day. You've got very young children, you're not really talking about it's not like going to school where you're going to be learning from one end to the other. There are lots of different skills that we want those children to acquire. And that really depends then on the pace of the day, making sure, as I say, that children actually can get out and about just as much as actually whether the sort of skills that they're going to be learning while they're actually with a particular practitioner.
Thank you.
I I'd support that. I think it comes back to the quality issue, and with the expansion to 1140, we absolutely have to make sure we have the right level of quality, because then I think the academic and experts on this would say if you expand and it's not good enough quality, you will have a problem in terms of the benefit to children becoming a disbenefit. So we need to make sure we get the investment, the quality, and the workforce is absolutely critical to that.
Okay, and before I pass on to my colleagues, Councillor Primer.
Could I just add to that as well? I mean, you certainly be very supportive of the 1140 hours. Nobody here would ever underestimate the necessity to have early interventions as early as possible. But also, we do have to build up to this. We have a significant amount of work to do. And I'd like to pick up the point as well that Claire made. We absolutely must start moving on the workforce issues. I saw a statistic, in fact, I think it was the Minister that told me this, look at 18,000 people. So we absolutely must get in to plan for this workforce. And I have raised that with the Minister, so I think that's absolutely critical. Of course, we need high quality. These are our young people. I would absolutely agree with that, but we do need to get a move on with that now.
OK, thank you very much, Joy.
Thank you very much. I wonder if there's any work being done on looking at how it's one thing to provide a nursery place you know, I mean, there's on the one hand, this is about childcare to support the families to go to work or whatever. The other bit of it is about education, supporting our young people to learn at an early, as early a stage as possible. Has there been work being done on the importance of closing the attainment gap at that very early stage, and what are the implications for that in the way in which you would then deliver the support that's there?
Certainly, I think if you look at some of the research that's been done through GUS, you'll find some very significant information there, which really points to the importance of the care and support theme that the practitioners are inspected against. Because what they were saying was that the only thing that was really making a significant difference to children's literacy by the time they actually started school was the quality of care and support. Now, there are various themes that practitioners are inspected against, but that care and support theme, I mean, it sounds sort of terribly obvious when you think about the needs of very young children, which is making sure, as I say, that their communication skills are good, that actually their ability to sort of interact with both their peers and also with other people is really good. And you won't be surprised to hear that that childminding is top of the list in terms of the way that they grade on that care and support theme, because they've got the smaller ratios, they can actually work. And where you've got the sort of community childminding services that are very much concentrating on early intervention, the results from that, both from their inspection and, as I say, backed up by through GUS, shows that that care and support theme is critical.
But I suppose the question I'm asking is, if two children arrive in school, one's in nursery, one's more disadvantaged than the other, and that is, will reflect in their literacy and their numeracy, should within the system be resources directed towards, specifically towards, closing the attainment gap? That is, that disadvantaged children will benefit more at age three from some from a nursery education than a child from a less disadvantaged background. And do you accept that?
I think, I would say, again, it's back to high quality. And as Maggie says, the quality of those adult-child interactions, so it is about having good ratios with skilled practitioners, because communication skills are absolutely fundamental. So there is definitely an argument to say we need to ensure more investment around the more disadvantaged children so that we can give them the better quality and the better level of input, which will help narrow that gap.
So does that mean within disadvantaged areas, for example, you would expect, and can ask Cosler this, that there would be a direction of resources, more resources to childcare centres in disadvantaged areas than elsewhere?
I imagine some of that will be picked up with the attainment challenge funds. I mean, obviously, you know, a lot of our early years assignments are within the context of primary schools. So I imagine there'll be co-work there as well. You know, I think points have already been made about, you know, young people, and the quality of care is absolutely pivotal for this. I mean, you know as well as I do that the earlier we can get interventions in, the more successful they are. So, you know, local authorities do this. You know, this is, you know, something that we work on. You know, we try and put as much money as we possibly can into disadvantaged areas. Because, you know, again, like Scottish Government, local government, you have a very great desire to work very closely with Scottish Government and really nail this attainment gap. And in order to do that, we need to start as early as we can. I know as well that we're talking about, you know, 2, 3, and 4-year-olds, but we also have to have the context too that you, even by 2-year-olds, we need to have interventions put in place even before that. So, you know, we need to have the health visitors again. We need to make sure we've got the recruitment levels right there. So, yes, I think local authorities do actually put in a significant amount of money into that area.
The new Education Scotland Act gives a specific responsibility in terms of school functions to address socioeconomic disadvantage, and therefore that's critically important in early years. So my question to you then is, do you have evidence, or could you provide us some evidence of the kinds of things that have been done in early years to address the attainment gap, as opposed to the generalised need of all children at the age of 2 and 3 years of age? Yes.
Absolutely, we can do that without an issue. Just one thing again, I don't want to go on about my own authority, but in my own authority, we have family centres in some of our most deprived areas. So children from as young as 6 weeks can access, not so much them, but their parents can access that. So, you know, there's support for the child, but there's also support for the parents as well. So certainly in my own local authority, I think we have 6 or 7 of these. So yes, we can certainly provide more detail on that.
I suppose my last point then is, have you done any work on testing? If we assume 1,100 hours is a great thing, it's a good thing, is there a test of, is it better than, in terms of outcomes, you know, that you might have a lesser generalised overall provision, but you have you redirect resources. I mean, has there been any work done in terms of testing the ideas of the different options? Or are you simply saying, well, that's a given, it's going to be 1,100 hours, and we will then make spending priorities round the back of that?
I was going to say, ironically, I think it is that ability to look across the whole of early learning and childcare rather than the specifics of the 1140 hours. And certainly the investment that has gone in many local authorities in their community child minding services, there is evidence there to show that that does improve and raise the attainment of those children. The evidence is there independently through research that we commissioned through Dr. Christine Stephen at Stirling University. Now that shows you, as I say, that if the conditions are right, that actually those children will thrive, and you can certainly assist them with that transition, both into sort of more group care or then on into school at a later date. It's how that actually then joins up. So that rather than thinking of this sort of early intervention for specific children aside from the 1140 hours, that's seen as one service. And in many areas, that's exactly what's happening. And I think that's what we need to see happening across more local authority areas, because at the moment, many of them are not using their childminding services in that way.
OK, thanks.
Can I just come in as well? Just saying that I've just been advised that pilots are taking place within local authorities to look at different models. And actually, when I think about that as well, we have that going on in my authority too. We have one early years establishment that's opening up at 8 and closing at 6 and things like that. So there are pilots going on at the moment. But again, we can furnish you with more information about that after this.
OK, thanks very much.
Liz?
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask a question of Claire Schofield. We've had substantial feedback from parents regarding the attainment gap, that when it comes to nursery provision, some children are receiving 2 hours of that provision, some children are getting 18 months, and another set of children are getting 15 months, and therefore there's a bit of an inequity in the system. Is that a genuine concern for you, and what do you think providers are saying about that?
I think as we move to 1140, there are a number of different challenges, and obviously the number of hours and the flexibility are a challenge. So if you add into that and the question about the birthday discrimination issues, it's been described as to how long you're going to get, that's yet another challenge to meet. I think we need to take a phased approach in terms of how many different things can you address at once and at what time scale would you do it. And for us, the fact that children would be increasingly having more of their hours in a whole range of different settings, that quality, that investment needs to be everywhere. So if we talk about disadvantaged two-year-olds and what we want to see in terms of the quality provision for them, we want that to be happening in the private sector as well as in local authority settings, as well as in childminding. And I think the kind of overriding concern for us is that we're going to see a move of the workforce from the private sector into the local authority. And if we don't do something to support that, or to stop that and support workforce quality everywhere, then there will be a real risk there. So yes, ideally, we'd like to see everybody getting the same amount of provision before they get to school. But I think we also need to think, how many different issues can you tackle at any one time? And so thinking about the priority on quality and the importance of narrowing gaps, I would say it's one that is important. We do get feedback about it. People do feel concerned that they're offering a different level of provision to different children based on their birthday. However, I think it's one that would be a better sort of looked at a later stage rather than the first priority.
Okay. Thank you for that. Just to pick up on the points, and also a point that was raised by Maggie Simpson, where you have to look at this in the round, that there is a holistic approach for early years. One of the things that interested me last week was the Scottish Government's thinking about consulting on something that was called the child account, which would be, as I understand it, an entitlement to a certain amount of money that would follow that child, and that would provide greater flexibility over the institutions that would provide the whole range of childcare from early ages right through before they go perhaps even beyond primary school. Is that something that is attractive, do you feel, for the parents that are trying to access childcare? And
certainly from our perspective, we have a lot of feedback that would be attractive for childcare providers and also for parents, because it changes the, I suppose, the starting point of how do you design a service to meet your individual needs, and it actually puts more power in the hands of the parent to design what best meets the needs of their children. Now, I think with that, we need to make sure if you had that move, that you had rules about how and where that account could be used. So it's, we're still directing it at high quality provision. You know, it couldn't be a completely free account, but you'd have to tie things, conditions into it. But certainly in terms of driving the flexibility and choice elements of the strategy, then I think that would be a really positive step.
Because as I understand it again, I think that the choice element is extremely important. That's what parents are asking for. But at the moment, that choice is compromised by the fact that some of the provision is inflexible in some cases because of the nature of the way that public and private don't always work together. And I just wondered if you felt that the possibility of a child account might get over some of that barrier, and also, of course, that would get rid of the birthday discrimination at the same time. But you see the way forward as having that greater flexibility for parents to decide.
And I feel that, you know, in that case, you have the sort of the classic situation of a child that would have to move because they cannot access their hours in the private setting they're in. So that can create all sorts of difficulties for a family trying to balance the work and life, other children, you know, which are quite obvious. So certainly that kind of approach would really enable parents to design what they need to meet their needs and the meet of the needs of the child without being forced into transitions they don't want to make.
Is that attractive to COSLA too, Councillor Primrose?
I mean, we're certainly prepared to look at things. I mean, at this point in time, COSLA does not have a position on that particular part of the child's account. I think we are still trying to, you know, look at the blueprint and try and get the foundations built, but certainly it's something we would consider, but we don't actually have a firm stance on it at the moment. I would need to go back to leaders on that.
I certainly think it's a problem at the moment for us, because you've got round about a third of local authorities who aren't using their childminding services at all. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in terms of choice, that's not even there. And yet, ironically, some of those local authorities are using their childminding services for vulnerable children. So you have that strange experience where the child is placed with the childminder for the very point that they've got the small ratio, they've got the high quality care and support, and then as soon as they get to that two-year-old, they're moved. Now, that makes no sense to me, and I don't think it's the intention actually within the local authority that actually that should happen. It's just at the moment that is what's happening, and there clearly needs to be some changes to that if that attainment gap is actually going to be sort of met.
Thank you.
The recognition that you know, child minders are going to have to play a role, a substantial role. Can I ask, but just on that, because I was going to bring that point up, from yourself, Councillor Primrose, why do you think that some councils are using child minders, other councils are not?
I think a lot of it depends on locality, to be honest with you. You know, I think perhaps, and this is just, you know, I thought really, that, you know, in rural areas, there's probably more authorities using more local childminders. But what I would like to say, as a point that Claire has made, is that we do need to build in flexibility. And the point was made that, you know, local authorities cannot, you know, take on, you know, 1,140 hours on their own. And we do need to build in flexibility. And I see childminders, you know, private nurseries and our own services being absolutely, you know, on a level playing field here. You know, we can't deliver this by ourselves. And of course, we would want to bring in our partners.
Okay, Ms Simpson, you seem to not completely agree with Councillor Primrose's...
The places where they are being used are actually, it's all over the place. So it is places actually like Aberdeen and West Lothian, you know, are using their childminding services as well. I have to say, I think a lot of that is because these areas haven't lost touch with their childminding services. They've been using them for other services like their community childminding. So the local authority have got a clear understanding about the quality of the service and how to actually make judgments about that. Whereas in some other local authority areas, where they don't have such a clear understanding, they're not really able to interpret the sort of information that they're getting through things like through the care inspectorate about the quality of the service, because they're not familiar with it. So they've just been slower to sort of move across and have that understanding. But we are doing work with Care Inspectorate and Education Scotland and the local authority to try and start to pull that together. But I would like, not surprisingly, to see a bit of pace on it now.
Thank you very much. Ross.
Thank Thank you very much, Convener. First of all, I just wanted to declare an interest as a councillor, still in Aberdeen City Council, and obviously refer members to my register of interests. It was just a supplementary, just to the first line of questioning, and a question directly to Councillor Primrose. Naturally, there was concern looking at the potential for underspend, as the convener had highlighted. I know, speaking to other local authorities, that absolutely they want to spend wisely and doesn't feel like any underspend. There's a challenge on how COSLA monitors the spend, but since this is funding coming from Scottish Government, in your view, what more do you think the Scottish Government could do working in partnership with COSLA to ensure that resources are being allocated correctly?
An interesting question. I think we do need to come up with figures, and you have agreed that we will do that. I think, again, I've spoken a wee bit about it, we do need to get the blueprint. I mean, I know that it's, I think it's heading out to consultation the next wee while. So we do, I think I'm actually going to take the point from Maggie as well, we do need to get a move on in this. So I think we do need to really up the pace of this. So if Scottish Government can get the blueprint and then we can get you that done, I think that will assist COSLA in actually, well, not just COSLA, but all our local authorities, in actually identifying where we do need to get buildings up and things like that. So I think blueprint is necessary. So I think it caused a wee bit concerned that, you know, we've got a lot of things going on at the moment, but we don't have the foundations there. So I think that would assist COSLA greatly in having the blueprint and actually telling us exactly, you know, what this 1,140 hours looks like. Coming from a COSLA point of view as well, is that, you know, this is about 2, 3 and 4 year olds. I think as well, COSLA would like Scottish Government maybe to think about, and I know it's not an ideal situation, but a learner journey. You know, so for example, if you have a 3 year old in a childminder or an early years centre, but a 6-year-old coming at a different time. So I think we'd like to see it as a whole process, about an actual learner's journey, if that would be at all possible. I have raised it, but I didn't get very far, I have to say.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Colin.
I hear a great deal about the need to have flexibility and choice for parents. Can I ask you, what does that mean? And secondly, how well are we actually delivering that at this point?
Interesting question, actually, because I think there were real concerns as well about the sort of patchwork, you know, would the child be sort of dotted from one place to another, and how would that actually affect the outcomes for that child? And certainly going back to sort of, you know, we've looked at that again, but I think there's a big difference between the choice, so that actually if you say, well, I'm going to map something together that's going to meet the needs of my child. When we were talking about the pace of the day, so it might be that part of the day was in a group setting and then part of the day was with the child binding service. That's what happens now. Then actually you've got something that is feasible and workable, that will actually work both for the family, but will absolutely work for the child too. So it's really kind of making sure that that is the way around that it's done and the way that it's decided, rather than saying, well, you know, the needs of the working family, they wouldn't be disregarding the needs of their child. But there were real concerns about that. And I don't see there's a problem with building that flexibility and choice in. You just need to kind of, as I say, look across the whole of early learning and childcare and not just those 1140 hours.
You seem to be saying it's all about hours.
Well, it's not all about ours. It's, as I say, it's making sure, as I say, that what you consider the needs of the child first and what that child is going to be enjoying and what that child is going to benefit from. And that can have that mixture of provision.
I would say there's also a question. You do have to keep the needs of the child central. And I think there are questions about the time of day, you know, in terms of what time of day provision is happening. And that is very much where partnership between different providers comes in. So you have childminders working with centres and have really strong transitions. So there's that relationship between the practitioners and they're sharing that information with each other and with parents. And I think, you know, in terms of being driven totally by the needs of flexibility for work, clearly the policy has come the other way around. We are told by the Minister, the priority is very much around quality outcomes and improving attainment. And that's the first priority. And we have to keep that in mind when services are designed. So potentially there is a limit on how flexible you should be, how many different transitions a child should have during the day, because you will potentially get a negative effect. So yes, there should be partnership and joint working, but also there has to be a kind of, I suppose, a sensible approach on how far you would go in terms of, and what kind of provision is appropriate at what time of day to meet the needs of a child.
I mean, I would agree with what's been said, you know, and I think the point that Claire made in particular, we do need to bear in mind this is about GIRFEG. So you know, what is right for one child may not necessarily be right for another child. What is right in one local authority may not be, you know, the greatest idea in another local authority. So again, it comes back to that idea about flexibility.
There'd be some need for some sort of common standard here, and I'm looking at the landscape of who's delivering. I mean, you've got local authorities, you've got private sector, you've got not-for-profit organisations, and then you start bringing in the, you know, the childminders and so on. How easy is it to make all these different pieces fit together to suit the needs of individual children?
It's not. It's not, and I suppose that's the problem in a sense at the moment, is that, you know, you're moving at a pace towards providing those 1140 hours. And the difficulty, of course, is how do you then put that flexibility in with it at the same time? But I would have to say that at the moment, you have that type of provision. It's just not under the umbrella of the funded hours. So you'll have lots of children who will be going to their childminder in the morning, who will then be taken to their nursery placement. The childminder will come and collect them, and the parent will collect them from the childminder. So you've actually got that there. It's just it's not within that blueprint of what the expectation is within the funded hours. So I don't think there's a problem in terms of delivery. I think there's a problem in terms of how local authorities now look at that in terms of their planning process to put that all in there.
So do you feel local authorities should be the ones that are driving this? And clearly somebody has to.
It has to be the local authority. They're the people that will be commissioning those services. So, and we've got somebody now who's as an early learning and childcare officer who's going around talking to individual local authorities to actually give them a better understanding about the childminding services that they've got in their area, and actually how they can map those into to the provision that they're actually looking to deliver.
Just add to say, sorry, in terms of it's already happening, but it also, the access to 1140 may open up new demand from parents who aren't already putting together those sorts of packages because they're not paying for the services themselves. So new demand from parents who are maybe using informal care from friends and family, but now actually would take the opportunity to move into using a childminder and a nursery or something like that. So yes, it is already happening, but we will have to see what the trials bring out and what the first, you know, initial stages of rollout are like. But I would say we could expect it to happen more. And so that creates more demand and, again, more need to make sure that all provision, wherever it is resourced to enable it to happen.
How good are we?
Gillian?
I do want to come back to this resistance from some local authorities in using childminders. Again, a couple of questions around that. Is there a correlation between the local authorities who are not using childminding services and those that have the underspend, first of all? And I also have another question about the flexibility across the border of local authorities. So, for example, if you take my previous situation when I had young children, living in Aberdeenshire but actually working in Aberdeen City, is that going to be looked at where there's maybe arrangements between the flexibility from maybe being in one local authority area as a constituent and council taxpayer, but actually requiring childminding services that are more in keeping with where you actually work? So has that been looked at all?
I actually don't have the answer to that one, whether it links the underspend to the not using their services. But I can find out. I mean, I can do that sort of linking because we're commissioned certainly to produce that report on an ongoing basis about how childminding services are actually being used. But I haven't linked it to whether they're actually the ones with the underspend at the moment. And as I say, the irony is that it's not even just about whether not being used for the funded hours. It's the fact that being used for community childminding services and not being used for the funded hours is probably more of a concern to me at the moment. And I don't think it's actually... it's not deliberate, in fact, from some of those local authorities. They haven't had that discussion and saying, no, I'm not using my childminding services. They just haven't put it into the framework yet. And I think that's part of the work that we've been commissioned to do, is to actually bring that to some of those local authorities to say, these are the services that are actually available, this is the quality of those services, this is how it can fit in. And apart from, there aren't too many that are saying, not yet, or no, not at all. They just haven't got to that stage yet. I have to say, though, in the other side of that, though, is that even those local authorities that are using their childminding services are not giving it as an equal choice. So what they're doing, and I suppose if I was sitting there balancing the budgets, I would maybe be doing much the same thing, which is that they're filling up their own places first. So it's only if there isn't a vacancy in some places that they're saying, OK, there's an option here to use a childminding service. And I think those are the sorts of things, as I say, that need to change just as much as anything else, because otherwise, as I say, you really aren't going to be meeting the needs of those children as well as you might be able to.
So it should be driven more by parental choice, first of all.
It's driven partly by parental choice, but very much about the needs of those children. So as I say, where you've got a placement already made with a community childminding service, specifically because that recommendation, in some cases from the health visitor, has been that that child needs that small ratio, that mixture. In fact, I think some of the evidence is here in your SPICE review that actually tells you that those children really benefit, not just from being with a small ratio, but also being with a mixed age group, being mixed sort of with children of different sort of capabilities, so that they're not sort of sitting there thinking, I'm a disadvantaged child, but actually far from it. They're just a two-year-old in a setting that is perfectly capable of providing for their needs and integrating them well. And I think Claire mentioned that about those sort of transitions into other services that happens really well where it works well, so that there's a good link between the childminder and the nursery, so that they have a better understanding about what that child's needs are and move them on.
Yeah.
But yes, that's a challenge.
And I suppose my second question is really more for Stephanie Primrose about the current cross-border arrangements between local authorities in this regard.
There are actually cross-border instances of this, and I'll certainly get the examples to you, but that does actually take place as we speak. So I don't have the precise local authorities who do that, but I will get that to you.
Right, okay.
Yes, actually, that's absolutely right. And where it works well, it's the usual old story. Where it works well, it works really well. Mm-hmm. And where it doesn't, there seems to be no logic to it at the moment, but that's easy for me to say.
Okay.
Thank you, Julian. Daniel?
I just have a supplementary on the points around flexibility. I mean, I think sitting here as a parent to preschool children, hearing that talk about flexibility, about making different elements or different sources of childcare work together within a single day, is probably not the way most parents think about flexibility. You know, what they're thinking about flexibility is around their working day, and actually having a child move between providers in a single day is far from what they want at all. They'd want provision flexibly from a single provider, certainly within a single day, probably even throughout the week. I mean, is that not the real challenge? And I'd probably just sort of, you know, put that to you, Claire.
I mean, that model is what the private and third sector nursery model is. You know, they're providing full day service for a parent that works traditional hours. Now, I think, so they, if that's a parental choice and that's where parents want to go, then that's a good option for them. But I think also as we move to 11:40, we will get more, and we're not a 9-to-5 Monday to Friday world anymore. So there are parents who work all sorts of different hours who will have other needs. So I think the initiative certainly needs to look where that works, where parents work non-traditional hours and need care at different times.
Yeah.
I mean, is that the case, though? Surely, actually, as a working parent, what you need to know is that this is managed for you. So you need to know that you can drop that child off and that you can pick them up. But what happens in between is up to that range of providers to manage for you. So you'll drop off at your childminder. You don't need to worry about whether that childminder is going to get your child to nursery and bring them back again, because you've already made that arrangement with them. So it's not that they have to stay with the childminder all day long. From your point of view as a working parent, you need to know that actually that's managed in the best interest of your child.
I would challenge that.
Yeah. Could I ask both the committee and the panel to speak through the convener? Because
I'm sorry,
what
convener.
Happens is we're getting a lot of
Apologies.
Different conversations going on at the same time. Daniel?
I think that the reality of childcare is that the moment that a child is being looked at after outside the home context, that is disruption. I mean, I think any... You know, working parent would recognise that. So that if you can minimise the number of changes, you know, certainly within a day, and I would say within a week, I mean, that is that 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 from just anecdotally, I think that's what parents are after. Now, yes, I recognise that that's what a lot of parents need to make it work, but I don't think that's the ideal. Far from it. And I think the more, you know, any preschool child will, sorry, just I'll just finish on this point, you know, is exhausted, frankly, by multiple things happening in the day.
Who's exhausted? The parent or the child?
The child.
The child. I would argue that's not necessarily the case. If, as I say, you've got to work it round the right way, you've got to look at the needs of the child, and if that is that you put together two services, that you're actually taking them to nursery or you're taking them to childminder, nursery, childminder, so long as that is actually working for the child, then actually that can work better because than actually having one service that may not meet the needs of that child if that's a prolonged day. It depends how that's actually organised. So as a parent, what you need to know is that that's going to work for your child rather than it's one specific model. No?
Okay, thank you. Ross, you've got a small supplementary.
Yeah, a small supplementary on the back of Daniel's question. Out of interest, and just to throw it out there, just to hear your own feedback and evidence, since it is an evidence session, educationalists in the Northeast are telling me that there's also a balance to be struck and to try and find ways where children aren't just in institutions and in nursery all the time, but even looking at things like stay and play, things where parents are able to interact and play with them, you know, helps with identifying early signs of mental health, the rest of it. Creative play is a really beneficial thing. How do we try and get that sort of balance right as well?
And in terms of sort of what's within, we're back to that kind of, do we just sort of chunk this into the 611,140 hours, or do we look at early learning and childcare? And I think you're absolutely right, is that those, you would always want to see good toddler groups, you'd always want to see stay and play sessions and those types of provision happening alongside of. In terms of how you actually evidence the sort of outcomes for children, what was sort of in this the statutory guidance was having a look at registered services, because from your point of view, they're therefore accountable, because you're either being inspected by Education Scotland or you're being inspected by the Care Inspectorate. So there's an outcome there that is actually evidenced in a different way. Now, that doesn't preclude those other services happening as well at all. What it does is it says what you're looking at is all of those services happening within local authority areas and actually designed to a certain extent by community planning partnerships that will have a look at the sort of broader needs rather than just that specific part of the legislation within the Children and Young People Act. So I absolutely see a place for those. It's just in terms of the actual funded hours, you're still looking at registered services. I think the two are complementary.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fulton. Very briefly.
Thanks, Convener. It's a small supplementary on Daniel's point. As a personal point of view, I would tend to agree with that I think that a child being in one place during the day is both better for the child and the parent. But again, I accept that's a personal opinion. But what I would say is the issue and the crux of the matter then, as we've already spoke about, not about where that place is and that making sure that all parents and children have access to everything. Because it's the big thing coming out for me is that the different local authorities are saying that different services are available and that parents should be able to choose whether they use a nursery, a childminder or a combination of both if that's what meets their needs. And it's sort of just come back to that.
There's that too.
Sorry, I'm then just sort of not communicating that well, because I do think, I mean, if you look at a childminding service now and the way that that currently works, one of the real benefits that happens with that childminding service is that, yes, that's within their local community and they're with a sort of mixture of age grade, but they also will use that local authority nursery service, because that's where that child is going to, at four particularly, meet with their peers, those children that they're going to go on to school with. And you wouldn't want to disrupt that. So as the parent, you might therefore choose to use that childminding service exclusively for the whole day because your concern is that the child is being chopped from one to the other. But that really isn't going to meet the needs of that child in terms of their ongoing need as they meet with their peer group and go on to school. So what's always worked well at the moment is not chopping and changing, but actually having, putting together something that's really going to meet that child's needs using those variety of services. So you'll quite often find again that childminders will take that child to the local toddler group for exactly that same reason, that they'll then be part of that community. So they're building up a whole community-based set of services that includes the local authority nursery, that may include other services as well. And actually, when you talk about the sort of the other children as well, because if they're doing a family service, then actually there's the needs of older children that come in, that you're then going to manage to go and get them to Cubs, that you take them to their swimming class, that you do all the things that actually might happen to that child throughout their normal day. So, as I said, I don't want to sort of throw the child from pillar to post. What you should be looking at is using those range of local services to build up something that matches around the needs of the child and also works for working families. A challenge, absolutely, but that's the challenge that's out there, and I think we should go ahead and meet it.
Yeah, but I'd like to move on. So, Richard.
Clearly, the government's policy on childcare is going to be transformational and one of the biggest policies we face as a parliament over the five-year parliamentary term. And I think Councillor Primrose mentioned that this may require an extra 18,000 people in the workforce. So this is a massive challenge. And I was looking at our briefing papers, and it says that the financial review published by the partner providers on the 27th of September estimated around 80% of practitioners and 50% of supervisors in partner settings are paid less than the living wage. So my first question is, how do we relate the paying conditions to attracting 18,000 extra people to the workforce over the next few years?
If I could come in, yeah. My convener. I absolutely accept that point. This is a hugely positive piece of governance, if you like. You know, I think the early years expansion is a very, very positive thing. I've already raised the issue with 18,000 people. I'm very fortunate. I co-chair the Developing the Young Workforce National Advisory Group with the Cabinet Secretary, and we've already raised that. We do need to have a kind of serious look at this, and we need to actually look at how we present this as a career. I was speaking to, I think again it was the Minister, and you know, what is it you're going to do? I'm going to be a hairdresser, I'm going to go into childcare. And we need to reverse that. We need to make people realise that, you know, childcare is a very, very worthwhile and important profession to go into. So I think we have a good bit of work to do there, and I think we need to go on with it, as I've said. Paying conditions, I can only answer on behalf of of my local authorities. We actually pay our paying conditions are in line with the Scottish Living Wage. So we actually pay, I think it's £8.33 an hour, which is actually slightly above the living wage within the rest of the providers, I believe. But certainly, as employers, we do take that very seriously, and the CBP is slightly advanced rate in that.
Yeah, it's a huge challenge. And for the private and third sectors, as you've pointed out, that is where the biggest gap is in terms of reaching the living wage. And to get there, we need a workforce strategy hand in hand with 1140 hours. We need investment. And I think completely agree with Councillor Primrose. We need to make it much more of an aspirational career path, that people see it as a profession they want to join. However, there has to be the reality to back it up. And so we need to make sure we get a better rate of pay outside of local authority centres, so that people aspire to those roles and then can be developed and can stay in those roles. Because with 600 hours, we've already seen that loss of practitioners into local authority services, and it just can't be sustained if we then move to 1140. So it's a huge challenge. It needs investment, and time is a concern because, as we said, we need to get on with it, but it's only a very, very short time away to make that kind of change in the workforce.
My members, of course, are self-employed, so the sort of it becomes even muddier because it's not a sort of living wage aspect to it. But nevertheless, they are currently, and partly because they don't register with the SSSC, they're having to do training, workforce development in their own time at their own cost. And if you're actually looking to, you know, to make sure that those sort of quality issues are sustained as you use those people more in the future, then that type of thing has to be addressed. There has been some work now in terms of improving that sort of learning pathway, and as part of the sort of workforce and quality group, it was making sure, as I say, that there was some sort of much more sensible way that these people could actually progress to get those sort of qualifications, to get the sort of underpinning knowledge that just builds on their skills and experience that they already have. And I know there's no concern about the quality of the existing workforce, but if there was a big recruitment of childminding services in, you're going to have to make sure, as I say, you get the right people, because it's a very challenging job. Not only are you providing that quality service to young children, but you've also got to be running your own business, you're going to be managing your terms and conditions, the whole bit that goes along with it, and we just need to make sure we get the right people in, even if that takes longer.
So thank you for wanting back in.
Just a couple of points I'd like to make in that. You know, local authorities have identified that, and I think it's quite important to mention that local authorities do assist childminders in kind, if you like. You know, a lot of our CPD courses and things like that are open to childminders. And just another point about the workforce, I think we have a very good basis. If you look at how successful the STEM programme has been used, so I think local authorities, Scottish Government, I think we actually have forum on promoting different types of work. So I think we definitely have the foundations there. But again, I would agree with Claire, we do need to get on with this.
Okay, thank you. Richard, do you get that question?
Yeah, so what I'm trying to get my head around here is, are the right drivers at play that are leading the local authorities to take the right decisions over what kind of provision to make available in the local areas? And clearly, there's a lot of variables out there, and no doubt there's financial concerns, but there will be other rural, urban concerns and so on and so forth. And if there's a gap between what local authorities are paying their own staff compared to what they're negotiating with non-council providers, then clearly that's an issue that may raise some questions. According to the briefing we've got here, it says there's considerable variation across the country, from 92% of registrations with a local authority in West Lothian to 41% in Murray, which happens to be the constituency I represent. So I thought to myself, well, Murray is quite a rural area. Maybe there's a difference between West Lothian and Murray because of rurality. Then I thought, well, actually, there's a lot more other areas in Scotland that are even more rural than Murray. And I'm trying to get my head around what leads local authorities to take decisions over the kind of provision to make in their locality.
I would like to think that our decisions are led by what is right for the child. Certainly not getting in my own local authority. You know, we are trying to make sure that we have provision in every ward. As you know, early years don't have catchment areas and we don't provide travel. So I think that certainly local authorities are trying to make sure provision is where it's required. So for example, I don't want to go about my own authority, but we're putting provision in rural areas. I mean, actually, in one particular area, we're building quite significant additions to our early years provision. So I would like to think that local authorities are being driven by what's right for the child. You have obviously as well, and you said it too, the financial constraints are a concern. I mean, I know the budget statement won't be made until December, obviously because the Westminster budget's not been agreed on. But that is a concern. So I think local authorities are trying very, very hard to make sure they've got the right provision in the right place for that particular child, whether it's a childminder, whether it's a partner provider. I think that's the context that it's looked in. I don't think it's looked on as great money savings and things like that. I think there's a genuine concern, a genuine belief that it is actually gearfec in practice. I would like to think, self my own local authority, that would be the case.
Yeah, well. I
think I asked the question actually at the last sort of strategic forum that the minister chairs, that was that sort of impact assessment that actually before services are opened up, that it's sort of what impact does that then have?
Yeah,
sorry, joined up weren't sentences, what impact does that then have on the existing services in the area? Because ironically, and again, you know, there has been that in some cases in some local authorities where actually brand new buildings have come up, which have been absolutely necessary, but the impact has been that that's put out of business some of the local childminding services because they're not being commissioned in that area. Now, that's not the deliberate intention of the local authority. It's just, as I say, at the moment, partly because of the pace of change, partly because, as I say, of the sort of perhaps the lack of understanding that that isn't necessarily happening as sensibly as it should. So that rather than actually including in your workforce, you're actually not really doing that as well as could be.
Okay, expected. Thanks very much.
I would just say that in the private sector, in our latest survey, occupancy was at 77%. So that suggests you've got about a quarter of places potentially available. So given the level of expansion, we need to make sure that is used as well, because it's you're building on something that's already in place, and rather than duplicating that.
Very briefly, then, just to say that there's no simple explanation any of us are aware of as to why West Lothian is at 92% at one end of the spectrum, and then at the other end of the spectrum, Scotland, we have Moray and 41%.
Mm-hmm. No. No. And actually, just for the record,
I'll take that as a yes.
Tavish?
I think the trials will be very, very worthwhile. I think that I believe they have started, and I will stand corrected in that. So I think when we get the results of the trials back in, we'll be in a more informed position to maybe answer some of those questions. And with your indulgence, I think a point that Claire made as well about the 77% occupancy, I think we've got a bit of work to do with the vulnerable two-year-olds. I think there's a concern amongst some parents and carers that because the vulnerable two-year-olds are linked to the DWP and benefits, I think there's a suspicion there. I mean, that's certainly something that I'm picking up, that people worry that if their vulnerable two-year-old goes into childcare, whether it's in a childcare setting or whether it's in a child minders, that they worry that their benefits might be affected if they all of a sudden take their child out. So I think we've got work to do there. And I know the former Cabinet Secretary certainly picked up on that. And again, COSLA, we've been working on that too, to try and actually identify what we can be doing to increase the uptake of the vulnerable two-year-olds.
Maybe some information you could share with the committee on that then. That would be helpful. Tavish?
Yeah, thank you. 18,000 people by any standards of imagination is a huge number of people. Where are they coming from?
I think that's a very good point. We certainly had a long discussion this just a couple of weeks ago. I think we have to, I'm going to say this word again, we have to have a blended workforce. Somebody said to me the other day that we need to have a B&Q style taking this. So we're not just looking at young girls, 16, 17, yeah, going to college, that we do need to perhaps take in people who've raised their own families and want to come back in. We need to make sure as well that we have the flexibility for part-time work as well. So I really take the point as well that we need to make this a profession that young people and indeed older people, women returners to work, want to come into. So I mean, it is 18,000. I read a statistic that this particular growth in the workforce is probably the largest since the Second World War. Mm-hmm. And that's an incredible statistic if it's true and all that. But we do need to start targeting that. We definitely do. We need to make sure our colleges are up to speed and the courses are there as well. But I do think that we need to expand perhaps what women perhaps think of traditional, that young girls 16, 17 go to college to be a child carer. We do need to target women returners. We do need to target people who are perhaps retired. We need to target men. And I know the Minister is very keen on that when you talk about child care, most people tend to think it's ladies. And we do need to make sure that men can realise that just as men can teach, and I know that there's a significant discrepancy about female and male teachers, I think we do need to again take that whole workforce issue. And if I could go one step further, I think we need to have a very serious review of the whole workforce. I don't think we can see early years in a silo. I think we do have to look at workforce planning.
Yeah, but with great respect, Stephanie, you've got 4.5 years.
Yes.
Actually, you've got less than that.
Yes.
You've probably got 3.5 years, because by August of 2021, every parent in this room and every parent across Scotland is going to be expecting 11:40 hours, mm-hmm, because that's what the government said is going to happen. Mm-hmm. What I'm interested in is how we're going to get there. Do you think the plans, I mean, I take your point about the blueprint, but this is, as you said earlier on, going to be a local authority by local authority assessment. Mm-hmm. Maybe I can ask Maggie and Claire, do you think local authorities get that? Are they with your organisations now saying, here's this big 18,000 people target broken down by local authority area. How are we going to deliver this provision by four and a half years' time?
Everybody understands the scale of the challenge. Yeah. I think it's putting things into practice, and I think it would be going back to the, you know, local authorities have their own centres and they need to staff those, and we've seen the movement. You know, that is our members' biggest concern in terms of their workforce is how they retain and not, and basically not just be a training ground for people to come in and move on. I think also the statistic we need to look at as well is that at the moment, on average, 23% of partner provider income comes from local authority. Now, as that percentage increases, we do need to take the opportunity to make sure that it supports a living wage. Because, again, we need a campaign. We need to open it up and get all sorts of different people thinking about this as an exciting career with a whole, you know, huge opportunity around early learning and childcare. But we also need to get those people into all sorts of different provision and enable them to stay there. So funding rates need to support it, and affordability for parents needs to support it.
I have a concern that as we get closer to this, frankly, political panic will set in because different places around the country will not be getting anywhere near being ready to deliver this. Do you think at that point local authorities, quite understandably, will say, we've just got to get this done through traditional local authority mechanisms, in other words, local authority nurseries, and your parts of the system will get squeezed out in that?
I would really hope not. I think there's a very clear message that this is, everybody needs to work together on this. Mm-hmm. We are working closely in a number of different forums, whether it's on the workforce, whether it's on the 1140-hour strategic groups, across all of us, and there's a common understanding that we need to do this together. And frankly, I think the challenge is just too big. And one size doesn't fit all for families and children, so we wouldn't actually be doing them a service if we said, no, it's just going to be this model and that's it.
And maybe can I get you, Maggie, just also to pick up the point about, the Richard's point about the difference between rural and urban. I represent a very rural area. You're absolutely right, Claire. The local authority alone won't be able to do this, but are we doing enough in... I mean, how's it going to work in rural Scotland, where the challenges, I think, are even greater than, say, Glasgow?
Well, I suppose at the moment there's some obvious routes that would actually make life a lot easier, because, as I say, the opening there to use your childminding services, provided there, and as I say, 80% of them at the right quality that you could use them tomorrow. So Shetland, you've got 21 odd childminders there that you could be using today.
I do.
Mm. And at the moment you're not using your childminding services. Mm. You are, but not for your funded hours.
No, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's an obvious route for that. There's only 4 childminders in the whole of Scotland that are being used for 3- and 4-year-olds. So there's an obvious route there. Now, that's not because, as I say, local authorities have been making specific decisions not to use them. It's just that it hasn't happened yet. And I think, as I say, in terms of the kind of easy messages to get across, that there's an existing workforce at the right quality being able to provide the right service. Now, they're not going to solve all the problems, and they're not going to get you to 1140 hours, sorry. But they are going to make a significant difference. And at the moment, I'm very reluctant to agree to do any recruitment of childminding services, because they need to have a viable business. Now, there's no point in me going out there recruiting new childminding services only to find they're not going to be used, because that would be a waste of everybody's time and expense. But I think those reassurances can be made quite quickly, so that we have that plan over the next few years to actually get that in place.
Can I ask one final question, if I may, convener, to each of you? What is the one thing now that would make a difference in terms of delivering 1,140 hours? What's the one thing that needs to happen, whether it's managerial, whether it's workforce? What's the one driver that really would start to push this on?
Well, I suppose ours is the easiest, isn't it? Which is that, you know, you've got 32,000 places potentially within childminding services which
and
you could be using.
I don't want to set out panic bells and things like that. I think local authorities are actually certainly on their way. Again, if I look at my own authority, I mean, we've got some like 12 new bills coming up. So I don't think we've got a panic. You know, I think we do have issues. I think we do need to address the issues about terms and conditions, and certainly COSLA, we'll play our part in that. But I don't get a sense of a panic. You know, having spoken to the Minister a couple of weeks ago, you know, I think the increases will come in tranches. I don't think all of a sudden we're going to have 600 hours and then the next day have 1,140. Sure. So I think workforce plan would be an issue. But see, I'm not panicked about it. You know, I don't think that in 2020 we're going to have 1,140 hours not being delivered. So I would like to make some reassurances that local government are very much on onto this. You know, so we've got new bills going up, and we do need to push on the workforce. But see, I'm not panicked, not yet.
I would say that the workforce and ensuring that partner providers are funded at a rate where they can employ the workforce to meet the need.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Just sorry, convene one more point with that. It's interesting, actually, when you look at that between the 600 and 1140 hours, and actually, you know, to come back to the point you made way back, which is how do you actually prioritise? Because we have existing services that are really meeting the needs of those eligible children, or the vulnerable children in particular. And I think it's really important that we look more carefully at that. And if actually there are going to be sort of priorities made over the next few years, I would urge that those are the ones that should be prioritised. And we've got a good mixture, either with your community childminding services or some of the other sort of services that are around, to really meet the needs of those children first, rather than worrying too much about how we actually get to the end point for all of the children all of the time.
Thanks very much. Liz?
Yeah, I'm still interested in this aspect of the flexibility, because it is obviously a real concern. You've given some very interesting answers when questioned about some spare capacity you think that might be able to use. You mentioned, Claire Schofield, that perhaps, you know, another 20% plus is available, and on childminding there is concern. What do we have to do, as Tavis Scott has rightly asked, about the terms of delivery for these extra hours? How can we ensure that parents will use that spare capacity? Because it's obviously an important part of it. What can we do?
Yeah, well, I would say the childcare accountant, exploring that is one way forward. And allowing parents to decide where they're going to use their hours. So, you know, we have providers who tell us that they can only offer so many places, so they're rationed in how many families they can offer a place to, or and that limits it. And again, providers in a minority now, but that aren't in partnership, and if they are good enough quality, they should be brought into partnership so the capacity can be used.
So we need to get rid of that rationing. And what's the best way of doing that?
Well, the childcare account is one way, or to move to a presumption that a parent can go to a local authority and say, my child is here and I want my child to stay here, and the funding follows the child.
Okay. I think that the information certainly that needs to go out to parents as well, because in a sense we've sort of trained parents into one way of thinking, and that's not easy to change. And I feel for those parents that are all of a sudden being told, having been told for years that, you know, their child gets to a certain age, they go to nurseries, 2.5 hours, 3 hours, 10 minutes, and that's it, and, you know, that's just your child will be fine, off you go to school. Now, to change that and suddenly say, well, actually, you know, a childminding service might actually meet the needs of your child differently, it's going to be really tricky to do. Mm-hmm. And the information actually isn't out there for them at the moment. It is, to a certain extent, coming from Scottish Government, but not really. Most people hear about, you know, nursery and all the rest of it by word of mouth, don't you? You hear about it from neighbours and friends and all the rest of it that says, get your child signed up. So there's a real information work to be done to actually help parents make some sensible decisions about what's really going to meet the needs of their child.
And would you have a recommendation of how we can better disseminate that information?
I think the trick is, please don't give a paper guide, parents' guides to, you know, I would get bored after about 2 seconds. There are so many ways these days in terms of actually better advertising, you know, what sort of services are about, to give people a real understanding about that and actually start to encourage parents to use them. Parents are the best sellers of those types of pieces of information. We need to help them along. There are plenty of ways to do that.
Okay, thank you.
We would certainly agree with that. You know, we feel that the 600 hours perhaps wasn't as widely publicised as it could be. And we would certainly agree that, you know, we do need to, you know, make sure that there's a big public awareness campaign in whatever format that would take.
Is that you first?
That's me, thank you.
Daniel.
Just really want to come back on the point about funding levels and the living wage, and especially to you, Claire. I mean, I think that private providers, I believe, are provided £3.59 per hour per child. If you've got a staffing ratio of 4 to 1, doesn't take a lot of arithmetic to work out. There's not a lot of change out of £8.25 an hour for a staff member, especially supervisors,
yes, absolutely.
And you need kind of spare capacity to deal with sickness.
Yeah.
Do you think we need to sort of have a fundamental rethinking of kind of the funding formulas and I think baking in the living wage at the, as a starting point rather than a nice to have if, it, if you get there with that.
Absolutely, we'd be very keen to look at that, and we're very pleased to hear the Minister say that he wanted to talk with us about how we look at the living wage and how we can make that a reality. So absolutely, and I think as well as the funding rate from the local authority, we also need to think about the parents who are not yet eligible for 1140, because you know you can't have one member of staff paid because they're working with a three-year-old one rate and a different rate for the one working with the two-year-old. If it's a living wage, it should be across the whole nursery. Now, what would the knock-on effect be for people buying privately their hours for their baby and their toddler before they're eligible? So that, you know, there's a whole issue about the funding, but there's also an issue for parents and what that move would do to affordability as well.
So I'm going to believe that your organisation states that private providers make an average loss of £1.88 per child. Is that correct? And how do you arrive at that figure?
That figure comes from providers. We ask providers what the shortfall is on the from the local authority rate on the hours that they provide. So it's the difference between the rate they're funded and the rate that they would be able to charge a parent for that same hour. And that's an average. I think 70-odd percent of members say they have a shortfall, and that's the average of the ones that do have a shortfall.
Okay, thank you. Very briefly, please.
There was some work done as part of the financial review by sort of Ipsos Mori to go and have a look at childminding services and their actual costs, which are somewhat more difficult to kind of to fine-tune down to something very specific, but we worked together with them, and I think what they found, of course, was that the variation was bigger than the commonality, so it depended how they actually costed their service. But ironically, you've got some childminders, again, who are being commissioned by the local authority for community childminding, and then, actually, funnily enough, as Claire says, you've got the same child from the same local authority, and the rate of pay is completely different. And it's really up to the childminding service to make some decisions about whether they're prepared to go ahead and continue to provide that type of service, or in fact, you know, do they make decisions about where, you know, what's going to actually make their business viable. Interestingly, at the moment, they don't seem to be making those decisions quite as harshly as that. If they've got a child, particularly an eligible child that's coming in and they really make some impact through their community childminding service, there is no way they're going to actually stop that service and say, I'm sorry, but that's not enough money. But I wouldn't want to see that sort of pattern continue. It needs to be realistic to actually the service that they're providing.
Thank you very much. Daniel, you get any other questions?
No.
Right, thank you. Ross?
Thank you, Convener. Following on from Tavis Scott's questioning about workforce, I would just like to tease a little bit more out from Councillor Primrose, a couple questions around about workforce and staffing. In Aberdeen, I've been told that to meet the 2020 requirement, they're looking at around about an additional 267 staff in total. So that's practitioners in total, that's including your early years, as well as Aberdeen has some teachers in the nursery too. So that's the total figure. At the moment, the council has a cohort of 40 supported places in training. That is just to meet the current statutory demand, not the 2020 demand. Therefore, can you give me an idea in terms of the authorities that you represent, where they are with that in terms of training, if you're aware, if they've raised any concerns with you about the people who are going through the process? And two, do you think there's the possibility for actually local authorities to commission places? Because I know the Scottish Government is liaising with colleges and universities, but do you think the local authority could commission them themselves?
I'll give you one example. It's an authority I don't represent, but I'll give you it anyway. Sure. Aberdeen, you work with the issues surrounding the gas and oil, and I know we don't maybe perhaps have the full picture of that, that people are being taken out of the gas and oil and actually trained. You know, I think it was on Report in Scotland. So that type of thing, you actually reskilling people is a good idea. What I've said before, and it's a thing that I am actually concerned about, I don't think we can see all this in isolation. I think we really do need to sit down and have a proper discussion about the workforce from start to finish. 40 places, you know, when you're looking at 270-odd, we do need to look at that. And again, the Scottish Government and COSLA is very prepared to sit down and have any discussions on that. But I think too that we can't just see early years in childcare. We need to talk about the whole, from 0 to 18, really, as well. But there are good examples. So that's the one I do know about in Aberdeen. But other areas are doing that as well. Modern apprentices, That's a very, very good way of bringing people in. But again, maybe it goes back to a point I said to Mr. Scott, that, you know, that is young people. So we do need to actually look at how we bring in people from, you know, that are maybe not quite at school. And again, we need to make sure colleges are up to speed on that as well.
Yeah. And obviously, I appreciate you're here representing COSLA. I know that the SLGP, obviously, who represent another number of local authorities, have been quite explicit, saying that they have a number of concerns around about resources in particular, and felt that there wasn't maybe great partnership working or consultation from Scottish Government. So I'd raised a number of concerns and I think written to the Minister. I mean, do you share the same concerns that the SLGP have raised?
Well, with all due respect, I wouldn't be in a position to comment on that. I don't actually know what the SLGP have said. Sure. So if you don't mind, I would not comment on that.
In relation to authorities, and you do represent the capital side, as we know, again, just to refer to Aberdeen, my own authority, we're looking at additional 3,500 places by 2020. Now, that means capital investment, that means new provision, and they're looking at about 15 new nursery provisions in itself. Obviously, there's difficulties with access to land to ensure that you actually get the provisions in the right places. Now, obviously, I'm speaking from a very local perspective, being representing the northeast of Scotland, but can you give me a greater sense of the challenges, or if there's similar challenges in other parts of Scotland with the authorities you represent?
There certainly are similar challenges. And we were discussing this again with the Minister just a few weeks ago. I think we need to start looking at other opportunities. You know, for example, I think it was the Minister said that, you know, if you have a building that's not being used, you don't necessarily need to go and build a new building, but what you can do is you can adapt that. So, I mean, I think Mark said something about a church hall, that if the church hall was there and not being used, then why would you not convert that if the building was appropriate? So I think we do need to look at different ways of actually providing that. And just to pick up a point you've said as well, your local authorities are spending phenomenal amounts to make sure that we have the provision there. And I know as well that a lot of authorities have spent money in making sure we've got a specific provision for two-year-olds, because two-year-olds, you know, require different things to a four-year-old. So these are things that are going through local authorities on a daily basis.
Ms. Simpson.
That specific point as well, I would urge real caution at the moment, because the new build is great, and there's a lot of work being done on what the building can be like, even adapting existing buildings, great idea, but increasingly in some cases what we're seeing is the use of premises or even individual school classrooms that aren't appropriate. You know, you've got wrong size furniture. I mean, everything as straightforward as that, because local authorities have been pressurised into having to move quickly, and I know that's not what they would necessarily like. Equally, in some of your more rural areas, you've got that move. So you're getting four-year-olds put into primary one classes in order to make space for two-year-olds at the back. Now, that's not what people would want to see, but that's what's happening in practice. And I think as we move forward in that next 4 years, those sorts of things, quite rightly, I'm sure, COSLA will be supporting that actually doesn't happen. It's a real challenge in terms of builds and making sure that something appropriate is there.
Come back in here, Councillor.
Could I just move to make some assurances there that local authorities do adhere to the Care Commission standards?
Oh, sure.
Thank you very much.
Brief comment. Just, I think that's a very good point, because in relation to making sure it's absolutely right, and especially in relation to new build, and actually some of the concern that's been expressed to me is that actually get some of the new provision in place. Essentially, it should have started last year if it's to meet the deadline by 2020.
So again, Convener, I think you'll find that things have started last year. I mean, certainly, you know, we're actually starting to open buildings now. I know if my authority's doing that, you can expect that a lot of the other local authorities are doing that too.
Okay. Thank you. Very much. Daniel, you wanted to come in very briefly.
Yeah, I mean, I know that one of the issues for local authority provision is that, you know, just a little bit higher than 40%, a majority can't actually provide, you know, lunch. So some of the capital kind of expenditure is actually, you know, pretty fundamental. You can't just open the classroom to start providing lunch. I mean, have you done an assessment of the capital requirement to actually put that provision in place? So that, you know, essentially we can, because I think you need to be able to provide lunch to get past this sort of 3 hour, 10 minute kind of block.
Absolutely. Again, COS is aware of that, and if you want precise figures, I can get that to you. I don't have them with me today.
That'd be really
but
helpful.
Certainly, you know, that perhaps goes back to a point I made as well about the LFRs. Yeah. That, you know, the free school meals and things like that haven't been taken into account of the LFR, and I know we started on that, so yeah, but certainly I'll get figures back to you about the actual cost of that and the free school meal entitlements.
And just given the capital constraint that councils find themselves under, I mean, do you think that there's an adequate amount of capital there to actually make those investments and build those buildings?
Well, coming from local authorities, there's never enough capital, but we'll make do and mend. But no, I think, as we go on, you know, I think increasingly our new bills will incorporate that. So at the moment, you know, we are pushing hard on this. So I think capital wise, so from our own local authority's point of view, we're going to be spending more than we actually get. So I mean, that's an issue, but then that's up for each local authority.
And so do you think you'll be able to get local authorities where the majority of provision can provide full day provision?
I think that'll be within a context of, again, hate to use the word flexibility. And I think, again, the trials that are coming through will actually show us, you know, what type of things are actually required by parents and children.
Okay, no, I'm going to move on. No? Okay, well, then I will let you in.
At the moment, those, you're right about the costs for lunch, because, as Councillor Primrose said, those costs are not yet being transferred across in terms of the private sector. So I don't know, Claire, I'm sure you'll say that too, but certainly with the child binding services, that hasn't actually been costed in yet. So at the moment, they're providing that as part of what they're getting for their fee.
Okay, thank you very much. Does anybody else have any further questions? In that case, can I thank everyone for attending today? It was a very useful event, and I thank you for your time. And that brings us to the conclusion of the public part of the meeting. Thank you very much.